God is going to cause you to rise up. And the one that looked lost and confused, which was you and I, is going to rise up in a certain strength, a might. This is our 30th year. And it's going to conquer and subdue, and it's going to strike fear in the hearts of everybody around them. And this is no small group. This is millions of people, man. Millions of people. As the stars which are innumerable in the sky. This was the covenant that God gave to Abraham. Remember the covenant that God gave to Abraham? You know what they said about Abraham? One man as good as dead. He had no children. One man as good as dead. Just about 100 years old. His family line was just about over. Counting them out. Your life is just about over. Just about over. Wait a minute. One man as good as dead. God said, nope. And here we are, millions of them. Millions. And not only that, he goes on and says, and may you be multiplied 1,000 times more. And that's today. Billions of us. From one man as good as dead. Oh, man, that's God. God likes to work that way. He likes to take you to you're absolutely done. And everybody around you, you included, say, I'm done. And then boom, boom. All of a sudden, this lost, confused people becomes a mighty army. It's going to conquer everything in its path. Oh, my goodness. And Scripture goes on to say that as they conquered the land, these first two kings had no idea what was going on. They said, you wilderness wanderers, you're going to come against us. They weren't the first to be struck down. I want to talk about, the Amorites. I don't know if anybody remembers the Amorites. The Amorites were the first nation to destroy or defeat the Israel nation 40 years prior. When God told Moses, go take the land, and they foolishly sent out the 12 spies, right? 12 spies came back and said, we can't do it. We can't take the land. God told them all, that's it. That's it. You guys are going to wander in the wilderness. You didn't believe the word of God. I told you, don't be afraid. Take the land. You're going to wander the wilderness for 40 years. They said, no. We can do it. We can do it. And they went to fight the Amorites. It said the Amorites came out like a swarm of bees and destroyed them and chased them out of the land. And they lived with that for 40 years. It says they were like bewildered, like they wandered around for a while. They didn't even know what to do. Really, they wandered around Mount Sinai for 40 years. That one defeat. They said, this is nothing. We can take care of it. Moses says, I don't think so. I really, like a swarm of bees, they came out. The Amorites. The first nation they destroyed, when God said it's time, they destroyed the Amorites. I know some of you don't like to hear this, but anyway, every last one of them. The whole world knew that something had changed. These confused wanderers have come back. And we don't know who they are. And then they went on to the next king, and the next king says, no problem, we got you, and destroyed them, every last one of them. They went on to the next one, three of them, three kings, three lands, destroyed them. Because it was time. It was time. Those who lived in confusion all of a sudden became mighty and powerful. Shaking the earth and caused everybody around them to be afraid and take note of God. See, God's got time. You don't think you have time. You think you're on your last breath. God's got time. He says, now, you ready? I said, ready? I just finished hanging it all up. No. I've been preparing you. Are you ready? Are you ready? To say that Moses didn't inherit the promised land in a physical way, wrong, he did. He just didn't cross the Jordan. But he conquered the first part of the promised land. If you read Deuteronomy, when, like I said, we're not going to read it in class. You'll have to read it at home. When Moses and the Israelites, they went to travel through these other kingdoms, they said to them, before they went to war with them, they said, listen, why don't you be nice like my brother and my cousins? Just let us go through your land. We'll pay for everything. Let us just walk through your land. Scripture says that God hardened their hearts and made them say no, because God was setting up a mighty, mighty, mighty feat here. God hardened their hearts, because if it said if they had any wisdom in their head, they would have let them pass through the land. They couldn't. God made them say no. God's in charge of everything. He's in charge of soft hearts and hard hearts. Whichever one you have or whichever one you think your neighbor has, God makes them soft and hard. Sometimes God hardens your heart for a certain reason. And sometimes he hardens your neighbor's heart for a certain reason. You say, oh, this pain in the neck of mine, it just won't stop. God's doing something here. Why don't we just stop and see what God is doing? My boss, my neighbor, I don't know, whoever, they just, my whatever family member of yours is, God hardens their hearts for great purposes. Everybody is not your enemy, but God is for you. And we must ask and say, okay, God, what are you doing through it all? Because there's no fear, there's no defeat. And God says, I'm going to harden their hearts, and I'm going to make them go to war against you, and I'm going to cause you to destroy every last one of them. Wow. That's a wow, isn't it, everybody? Okay, this is right here. This is right here. Let's move on. That's really profound. Somebody read. I want to read Deuteronomy 2:7. It's in your notes. Would somebody read Deuteronomy 2:7? Amen to that. Make no mistake, as you look back on your life, especially the times when you think that God was not with you, God was with you. You might call them saved moments or unsaved moments. Those words don't exist in the language of God, only in our puny minds and puny mouths. They don't exist in God. Because God saved you before the foundation of the earth. You were always his. You always belonged to him. And he was always working in your life and just chose different times and different seasons for you, everybody. And this here, it tells us as you look back on your life and or whatever you want to look back on the past 30 years, it says, listen, I've always been powerful in your life. Powerful in your life. And even in these wilderness wanderings, God says, I was so powerful, I caused your sandals not to wear out, and I caused your clothes not to wear out. Now, some of us might think, well, that's not the power of God. I'd like something new, if you don't mind. How about a couple of bucks in the bank account? God has done miracles in our lives. And if God would open up our eyes, we would see the hand of God on our life that got us through our everyday life. What got you through some of your hard days and wilderness days? God Almighty, not you and me, God Almighty. Well, you say, he barely got me by, okay. It was the mighty hand of God that delivered us and saved us and kept most of us sane. Some of you didn't make it. Some of you are absolutely crazy. I know we like to think that God is the one who fills our bank accounts. That makes me sick sometimes. That God is the one that keeps you healthy. Oh, yeah? Oh, yeah? Oh, yeah? I think most of us have lived enough life to realize that's not the truth. I think most of us have lived enough life where we've seen God through the times that you think it wasn't God. That sickness had a purpose and poverty had a purpose. And what is poverty anyway? Well, you're all rich in Christ. We think lack of dollars is poverty. Oh, it ain't. No, it ain't. The absolute power of God that sustains us in the wilderness is absolutely profound. And God uses those experiences to make us into something strong and beautiful, that it seems like overnight we are mighty and powerful. Listen, there's nothing overnight about this. He spent your whole life making you. And here you are. And here we are. He spent our whole life. And I love the fact that God brought us together here for a special purpose. And it's never about anything natural or physical. Sometimes you wonder what the great things of God are, because it has nothing to do with our natural minds or our natural obtaining of possessions. It's something greater. It's possessing our souls and our minds and our bodies. Amen? That's true riches. So we see that here in Deuteronomy 2:7, where he is the one that kept us and caused our sandals to not wear out, and our clothes not to wear out. And don't forget the manna, everybody. Don't forget the manna. The manna is the bread that came from heaven. For 40 years, bread came from heaven, and it landed on their doorstep. And mind you, it was just enough bread for the day, never enough for 2 days. But because we see just little amounts on the ground and we go and gather it up and it only lasts for the day, we think that our God is meager and our God is not rich and full. Or really? He caused bread to fall from heaven. He miraculously sustains us. Bread came from heaven to feed millions of people. There's no other nation on earth that would even think of experience bread falling from heaven. And they disdained it. Sometimes they would want enough bread for 2 days. Okay, but what about tomorrow? I need my riches for tomorrow. And they'd be tempted to put enough bread in that jar for 2 days. What happened to it? It rotted. Sometimes your blessing, it'll rot when you want enough for tomorrow. Just take care of today. God is powerful enough to take care of you today. Stop worrying about your tomorrow. So in this last passage here, I'm going to read this because I try to be mindful of you guys. Let me read this for you here. Deuteronomy chapter 3, verses 21 through 29. It says this, "And I commanded Joshua at that time, saying, your eyes have seen all that the Lord your God has done to these two kings," the one we just talked about. "So will the Lord do to all the kingdoms through which you pass. You must not fear them, for the Lord your God himself fights for you. You are be afraid of nothing." Moses said, "Then I pleaded with the Lord at that time, saying, O Lord God," I want you to take note of what Moses said here. He said, "You have only begun to show your servants your greatness and your mighty hand." I'll get back to that in a second. "For what God is there in heaven or on earth who can do anything like your works and your mighty deeds?" We'll get back to that in a second. And Moses says in verse 25, he says, "I pray, let me cross over and see the land beyond the Jordan, those pleasant mountains in Lebanon." Take note, verse 26, "But the Lord was angry with me." Says who? Says Moses. God wasn't angry. Moses was angry. God wasn't angry. "But the Lord was angry with me." And then he goes on with his tall tale. "On your account, you are the reason why, the children of Israel are the reason why I'm not getting my heaven." And that's us. We blame each other all day long. "You're the reason why I got no peace. And you're the reason why." That's Moses here. So he's not really in a good place right now. He says, "God, you're angry at me, and because of them, I can't get this." Okay. It says, "He was angry with me on your account and would not listen. So the Lord said to me," the Lord did say to Moses, "enough of that, speak no more of the matter." And he told him to go up to Pisgah. We talked about that. "Go up to Pisgah, lift up your eyes toward the west, the north, the south, and the east. Behold it with your eyes, for you shall not cross over this Jordan." Okay. That's the law, everybody. It's not, nope, you're not getting in with the Lord. Nope. This law, this angry God, nope, it's not the promise. No, it isn't. You don't get to heaven because of an angry God. Nope. Nope, nope. Or because of obeying a law. Nope, not getting you in. That's what it's saying there. Okay, everybody? That's what it's saying there. You obey the written law, it's not what's getting you in. You serve an angry God, you ain't getting in. I'm sorry. But command Joshua, Jesus Christ. There he is. There he is. Ah, Jesus Christ. But command Joshua and encourage him and strengthen him, for he shall go over. Jesus, the one who talks about love, he shall go over before the people, and he shall cause them to inherit the land which you will see. You know, we start to see God through certain Old Testaments and growing pains of knowing God. You get to see him, but you only obtain it through Christ, okay? All right. But I want us to see here, listen. Moses said God was angry. God wasn't angry. Moses said the people caused him not to go in. Not true. We're all responsible for our own actions just based upon that. But even back then, the people say that God is angry. And Moses said that God is angry. Moses said God was angry, and that's why I'm not getting in the land. No, Moses wasn't getting in the land because he didn't believe the word of God. You don't believe the word of God, you don't get in. It's not because God is angry. We don't have an angry God, everybody. All right? And then it goes on, and it says here in verse 24, as we close, thank you for your patience, everybody. Verse 24, it says, that only now, all of the great things that God did in Egypt and all of the great things that God did in the wilderness, it says, only now we're beginning to see your greatness. Moses says, wow, look what you just did. We just destroyed these two kingdoms. Like Moses says, oh my goodness, our God is so big and so great and so powerful. Only now they're beginning to see the greatness of God. And I believe that's where we are. That's where I am. That's where you are. That's where we are. We have not yet begun to see the greatness of God. And it's all done through a renewed covenant, an absolute new understanding of who God is and who we are and what's going on in this life. It's not this angry, punishing kind of a God. Can I get a witness from 1, 2, 3? Why don't you all stand? God bless you for your patience. And Pastor Dad, if you'll close us out.
Another powerful lesson.
Amen.
Oh, not enough. Come on.
Amen.
You talk about manners.
All right.
You just had a fresh delivery of manna. Hallelujah. I like the one statement. Here's the mic. This teaching is dynamic. It's a time for this teaching. And I think it coincides with what is happening in the Church of God. But we're coming into something new. And we do need to cross over out and away from the old. And the other statement you made is, you know, we don't get there because of an angry God. We're getting there because of a loving God.
Yeah. I'm not using this mic. Can you hear me? Did you hear me without the mic? I can turn up the volume. God has given me volume control. How's that? All right. Praise God. But we need to see. There's one passage that says, do not dwell in the past, Isaiah 43:18. But here God is saying, don't forget what I have done. And I think the lesson in that is so that you don't repeat things you shouldn't have done. And that's what Moses is doing. He said, this is what happened, and I don't want you to repeat it. So let me repeat myself to you as to their mistakes, that you don't make the same mistake. Hello? I don't want to make the same mistake. There's lessons here saying, don't make these mistakes. And I look at him and say, Lord, thank you. Because it's your love that gets me to heaven. It's your love that gets me closer to you. But it's my love for you that draws together. If any two shall agree, that's only going to happen because you love him. He already loves you. So it's powerful, Pastor Mike. It's powerful. I think you're a fantastic teacher. My estimation... I think my estimation counts a little bit. I've been around a few men of God. This man is a man of God, and so all my other sons, praise God. Right now, he's standing here before you tonight. So we're entering into something new, 2018. I heard something recently, and 2018, and there were two numbers that make 18. How many of you know the two numbers that make 18? 9 and 9 is 18. 9 fruit of the Spirit. 9 gifts of the Spirit, 9 and 9. So look for a full harvest of 9 and 9 as we enter into 18, into this new season, into this new thing that God has prepared for us. He said, I am doing a new thing. Do you not perceive it? And so Moses is trying to get the eyes of the people, this new generation. Open your eyes, because the other generation didn't see it. It was all there, and they didn't see it. I'm talking about with the eyes of the Spirit. I'm getting a little long here. I didn't mean to do that, Pastor Mike. But this lesson is so powerful, and I think we need to... Did you learn something tonight? Are you going to take something home tonight? Are you going to leave different tonight? That's what God wants, and that's what God is preparing for us. We thank you, Father. Lord, you're teaching us so much. And yes, we do need to learn. We need to look back and say, yeah, no. We don't do anymore. We crossed over. Hallelujah. Praise God. And we're going on to new things and love you, Lord, because we know you love us. Praise God. I think it's, Hosea 2:19. I love it. He says, I have betrothed you to me. The emphasis, I have betrothed you to me. Can we count on God for that? So I thank you, Lord, we belong to you. You have made us your own, and you shall continue to draw us, my God, closer, tighter, and a greater victory that you have prepared through Christ Jesus. We thank you for it all. And all of God's people said, amen. Praise the Lord.